roads and factors and founders. But Linda has been really the spark that got it going, and she's one of the catalysts that keeps the Clergy Project going. It was April of 2009. I was in the office. It was the day after Easter Sunday. I got a phone call from a Church of Christ minister in East Tennessee who told me, kind of whispering, that he had lost his faith, but he was still stuck in the ministry. And I knew that feeling. I told him about the Dennett La Scola study, and as you know, he jumped at the chance to participate as long as his privacy was guaranteed. He said he wanted to be known by the name Adam Mann, and that's what I know him as, is Adam Mann. In fact, I just checked my email. I have over 1,600 emails from Adam Mann over the years. And when the Clergy Project launched in March 2011, with about 50 or 52 current and former clergy who have abandoned it, Adam was an active participator, and he also helped establish the online forum and do all of this admin work, which was very, very useful for that. You might have seen he was featured on ABC Nightly News in 2010, interviewed by Dan Harris behind a screen about his story. We're pleased that this story is getting a wide coverage. So tonight, after being a closeted atheist in the pulpit for many years in the Bible Belt, Adam Mann just is going to come out here publicly as an atheist. He just left the ministry recently. So when you get to know him, make him feel welcome. Make him feel welcome at his first visit to a place of a bunch of godless heathens like you. Let him know what true heathen fellowship is all about. So I'm going to let him tell you his real name tonight. So Adam Mann, can you come up and then I can start calling you by your real name. Where are you? Here.
Wow. 8 years ago, I did not even know what a free thought convention was. Seriously, let alone ever dreamed I would be speaking at one. Thank you in advance for hearing my story. My story, while unique with my own personal situation and experiences, unfortunately is not unique across the country, or we found out even around the world, because of others who have found themselves trapped by the disheartening position of being a member of the clergy who all of a sudden finds themselves no longer believing in a God or the supernatural. So it's my hope that my story will bring hope to those that find themselves in that perplexing situation. Who am I? For 8 years, I was known as Adam Mann. I told Linda before I would be walking in the mall and I would hear someone say Adam and I would turn, but never say anything. My real name is Carter Warden. I was born in 1963. I was born an agnostic because I could not prove anything, but I was open to everything. I've lived in East Tennessee since I was 4 years old. So if you can't understand everything that I say, hopefully this will be in a written form later. What's the spiritual climate of East Tennessee, you might ask? Last year, the Tri-Cities, Tennessee, was named the third most Bible-minded city in the United States by the American Bible Society and the Barna Group, only behind Birmingham, Alabama, and Chattanooga, Tennessee. Participants are considered Bible-minded if they have read the Bible at least once in the previous week and they have a literal interpretation of Scripture. That's where I live. My early religious upbringing was United Methodist. But then as a teenager and then a young adult, I transitioned into the Christian Church, Church of Christ, which was the instrumental version, because there is a non-instrumental version of the Church of Christ, because we know how segmented the faithful can be sometimes. So I was born smack dab in the middle of American Protestantism. Why did I become a pastor? Originally, I was an automotive technician by trade with a 2-year associate degree. I was always very mechanically minded. Things are very black and white to me. They either worked or they didn't. There's always a logical reason and a corresponding repair. But after a few years of work and deepening involvement in my local church, I sought a more meaningful purpose for my life. And religion did offer that for me at that time. I had married my high school sweetheart. In fact, we just celebrated our 33rd anniversary. We have 2 grown children. But early on, my wife and I decided that our lives and our marriage even would be dedicated to ministry. So I went back to school and received an undergraduate degree as a Bible major, sociology minor, from a local Christian liberal arts college. I was ordained into ministry in 1988, and I began preaching in a local church. The Christian Church, Church of Christ, does not require that its pastors attend seminary, but I wanted more education. So I went back and obtained a Master of Arts in Religion. So for well over 25 years, I was active in ministry as either a youth pastor, preaching pastor, small groups pastor, administrative pastor of a large church, and also a worship pastor. And then most recently, all that was in the Christian church. And until recently, matter of fact, 2 weeks ago, I was a part-time musician and worship leader for a local United Methodist church. By the way, I am looking for work I can do from home or on the weekends now. This might shock you, but my church experiences were all pleasant. Every one of them. No horror stories. No feuds with congregations or with church leaders. Matter of fact, today, my lifelong friends are all in the church. Church members have shown concern and care for my family during some very difficult times, and for that, I will always be grateful. So what changed? My spiritual demise, as some would say, what I like to call my intellectual enlightenment, began in July of 2008, after nearly 20 years in full-time ministry. I was leading a small group Bible study, and we were studying this book called Unchristian. It is written by Christians, by the Barna Research Group. We were studying that as a small group experience. And the book tried to look at the way the world views Christians, and it focused on the Mosaics and the Busters, the 19 to 29-year-olds. You know, the group that the church always loses when they go off to college and they never come back. The research in this book represented the top six criticisms that non-Christians have about Christians. And here's the summary of it. Christians are 1, hypocritical, 2, anti-homosexual, 3, sheltered, 4, conversion motivated, 5, too political, and 6, judgmental. I would say they hit it pretty well on the head, wouldn't you? But I began to look at the big picture, and I took it serious. I tried to step back and see what we Christians look like from a non-believer's perspective. And as I seriously thought about it, I realized one day, I remember I was driving, and we had just studied that chapter in the book, and I thought on being sheltered, and I thought, if a non-believer approached me and tried to start a conversation about evolution, for example, there's no way I could even carry on an intelligent conversation. This was because most fundamental evangelical believers have shunned all secular and scientific teaching about evolution because it's taught by the church to be evil. And it directly contradicts the literal interpretation of Scripture. So I realized that book's right. The indictment of the non-Christians was correct. I was sheltered and I was ignorant about many things. So the book challenged me to do research on my own so that I might know my secular audience, you, so that I could win you to Christ. So I began reading anything and everything on the topics of evolution. Biology, cosmology, cognitive science, philosophy, world religions. And eventually I found myself secretly reading the books and watching debates by the four horsemen of the new atheism, Dawkins, Dennett, Hitchens, and Harris. I read books by Bart Ehrman, Dan Barker, Michael Shermer, Guy Harrison, Greg Epstein, John Loftus, Stephen Hawking, Stephen Prothero, Eugenie Scott, Victor Stinger, Jerry Coyne, Andrew Newberg, Ayan Hirsi Ali, as well as the writings of Bertrand Russell, Friedrich Nietzsche, Robert Ingersoll, Charles Darwin, Benjamin Franklin, and Thomas Paine, to name a few. But you see, I knew that if Christianity were true, that it wouldn't matter what I was studying. Surely God could and would honor my sincere inquiry into the big questions of life and faith. Surely searching for understanding and truth would even draw me closer to Him. I had always said a faith unchallenged is really not faith at all. And I always loved to quote Francis Schaeffer at the time, who stated, "For faith to have a conviction of a whole person, it must be based upon the mind as well as the heart." So I thought, okay. I found myself continuing to plunge into areas of study I'd never seriously contemplated. So between July 2008 and April 2009, I read over 60 books, listened to hundreds of hours of lectures and debates. I watched 25 documentaries and movies. I went through 8 college-level courses from the teaching company on philosophy, evolution, New Testament, world religions, biology, and human behavior. And although I had over 20 years of Christian teaching and doctrine as a foundation, I tried to balance my study so I wouldn't be swayed by one stream of ideology. Therefore, I read both Christian writers as well as non-believers. My complete study list, if you would happen to be interested, is found on Linda Lascola's Rational Doubt Patheos blog under the Media tab. All 33 pages of it, I believe. I also audited a graduate level class on the historical life of Christ to see what the most recent scholarship had to offer in an attempt to recover my waning faith. But the class only solidified my skepticism by showing how little we can really know about the life of Christ as recorded in the New Testament and its outside sources, and the plethora of variations and inconsistencies and contradictions in the text. But realizing I wasn't the first person to wrestle with doubt, I sought the advice of some people that I respected that I knew I could trust. So over a period of almost 1 year, I met with 4 different Bible college and seminary professors, 3 pastors, and even a professional Christian counselor whose official diagnosis was, "You have a conflict of careers." Now, while I respect each of these people, none of them had satisfactory answers. In fact, most of them, the majority, said that I needed to leave fundamentalism and move and minister in a more liberal denomination. They told me that I was interpreting the text too literally. And while this solution might and does work for some, I saw it as avoiding the ultimate question. Is there really an all-knowing, all-powerful, loving, intervening God as revealed in Scripture? Tell me, is there? Okay. That was a good response. My conclusion after 10 months of intense study and following study, and still to this day, is no, there is not. You are correct. So instead of deepening my faith, my intense study left me no choice but to abandon my once precious faith. I did not lose my faith as though it was something that regrettably slipped away. Rather, I chose to discard it because it no longer made sense to me. Some of the major reasons I no longer believe, in summary, are the contradictions in the biblical text, the discrepant, not only discrepant, but the despicable character of God in Scripture, the questions of theodicy, suffering in the world, the fallacies of answered prayer, the denial of modern science, and the harmful teachings of religion in general. I agree with Dan Dennett, who in the book Caught in the Pulpit, who, by the way, quotes some very good people, that the church has its hands full if it seeks to protect its lay people and even its religious leaders from the influences of the real world, end quote. Modern technology makes information readily available for anyone seeking answers, and therefore the church today faces the same dilemma that God himself fictitiously faced rather unsuccessfully in the Garden of Eden when he tried to keep mankind from that tree of knowledge. Shouldn't that be a red flag to people? Shouldn't that be a warning sign? Shouldn't that be a warning sign when open, honest inquiry is discouraged and even squelched? Faith and knowledge do not go hand in hand. To me, they're more like oil and water. Yes, you can temporarily mix them if you constantly and vigorously shake it and work at it, but when it's left alone in its natural state, they repel each other. So what is a non-believing clergy member to do? Dan shared that on the day after Easter Sunday in 2009, I gathered up the nerve and I looked up the phone number to the Freedom From Religion Foundation, and I called and I asked to speak with Dan Barker, and I was surprised. Dan Barker got on the phone. He answered the phone. I was sitting in my church parking lot. Dan doesn't know this, but I had blocked my number on my cell phone just in case this unknown atheist tried to turn me in to the church authorities or to a news agency. I had read his book, Godless, which was a fairly new book at that time, and I just had to speak with somebody who had experienced what I was going through. I told Dan my entire life had been given to God. My wife and my children and my extended family were all very strong Christians. Our lives revolved around the church. And Dan, you know what it's like? We were consumed by Christianity. It was everywhere in our lives. It was incredible when I talked to Dan, and he spent a long time talking with me on the phone. It was incredible to find someone who understood, someone who had once been passionate about God and ministry in the church, but has also changed his mind. Allow me to read part of my email the next day to Dan and note the fear of being identified, which we found out all non-believing clergy have, at least at the beginning. Dan, I really appreciate you taking my call yesterday. I'm writing under the fictitious name I've created and a fictitious email account just for such correspondence. I'm interested in you putting me in touch with the person doing the interviews for the Daniel Dennett Project. Again, I want to emphasize the need for confidentiality with you and your organization, as well as with the Dennett Project. I know you'll understand this. So I give you permission to give my email to the Dennett contact person. Sorry, I cannot remember her name. Adam. Thus, the beginning of Adam Mann and the first of over 2,500 emails with Linda LaScola, whose name I will never forget. So in 2009, I became one of the first active clergy members in the pilot study of the original Tufts by Dan and Linda. After that, Linda and Dan orchestrated secret interviews with ABC's Dan Harris and with the Canadian Broadcasting Company, and I was eager to participate in those. So since Linda's always shared about kind of what I did as a secret founder and a website technical administrator and a forum moderator, I just want to share what I learned about being a member of the Clergy Project, about myself and the now nearly 770 Clergy Project members. I learned that I'm not alone. Yes, that's... I learned that I'm not alone. I learned that reason and science are the best tools for people to discover truth, freedom, happiness, and purpose in this life. I learned that goodness and morality do not come from a God. Goodness, morality, happiness, compassion, love, self-sacrifice, and a desire to make this world a better place can be found within each one of us in our minds when we accept the role as the most evolved and most privileged species on earth. I saw this firsthand in March of 2013 when a former Catholic priest who was a member of the Clergy Project shared on the private forum that he had just been diagnosed with inoperable liver cancer. Roger's amazing positive attitude and willingness to share his pain and resolve with almost complete strangers was a very powerful testimony that there truly are atheists in foxholes, and that death without the hope of something beyond is not only fathomable, but it can be viewed as a welcome experience in this journey of life. Roger and I exchanged emails and spoke on the phone as he awaited his imminent death. I actually interviewed Roger for over an hour by Skype on one weekend, and he gave me permission when I had the time to edit and eventually share that video that we titled The Acid Test of Final Farewells, which was the title of his post on the Clergy Project. In fact, Linda and I hope to share that story on her video blog, that video soon on her blog. Interviewing Roger, he'd told me how inspiring the work of Richard Dawkins and Daniel Dennett had been at one time in his life. And I just wanted to do something for Roger. So I wrote Dan Dennett and shared Roger's story and gave Dan Dennett Roger's phone number. And I left it at that. One day later, Roger wrote me and said, "Adam, if you did anything to facilitate the call I just received, I thank you from the depths of my heart. It was a very heartwarming surprise, and damn near midnight his time. I had often watched him as one of the four horsemen, one of the pure essences of the goodness of this universe." Roger died peacefully at his home less than 2 weeks after my interview and Dan's call. Peace, compassion, purpose, all exhibited in the lives of those who are not believers. truly a real testimony of goodliness without godliness. So why go public now? You've hidden your identity for 8 years. Can't you keep it up? Who would want to? While doing one interview for the Clergy Project, I was asked what fears I had. And my answer was, my greatest fear is doing nothing at all and pretending to be someone that I'm not for the rest of my life. You see, all of us non-believing clergy have our own reasons for remaining closeted when we do. Many like me refrain from telling others because we don't want to hurt or embarrass family members or friends. Combine that with the financial stress of trying to change a career in midstream, and you can see why many learn to tough it out and put up with the cognitive dissonance and the gut-wrenching feeling of inauthenticity. Yet I longed for the day when I could be completely honest and transparent about the journey from faith to reason, especially with those that I love the most. In 2013, I realized I had to give up some of my responsibilities with the Clergy Project so I could truly focus on changing careers. Thankfully, I did find a good job at a local university, and I quietly, as I called it, oozed out of ministry. But because of the financial needs of my family, even though I wasn't working full-time in the church anymore, I was a part-time music minister. Maybe I should have been happy with the way things were, because who knew the difference? God didn't, evidently, right? What the people don't know won't hurt them, right? And I really did a try. For almost 2 years, I tried to see if I could live under the radar. I logged off of the Clergy Project. I gave up my responsibilities as website administrator and as a forum moderator, and I just logged off. I stopped reading about and corresponding with anybody from any of the free thought organizations. I even stopped emailing Linda and Dan Barker and Dan Dennett for an extended period of time. Maybe I could learn to live with the tension. And I did for a little while. But I still ultimately had to live with myself. During that time period, I attended several funerals. In fact, I sang at many of them for family and for friends. And each time I found myself barely being able to sit through the service. And I was thinking, what will they say about me when I die? I don't believe this that I'm seeing. I don't want a Christian funeral. But guess what? That's what I'm going to have because nobody knows any different. I would think, I don't want to be remembered as a spiritual person. I'm no longer a man of faith. I'm a man of reason. I'm a man who trusts science. I want to enjoy this one short life that I have. I want people to know that I rejected faith and lived a meaningful, happy life without it. I told that to my daughter one day, and she replied, "Dad, it won't matter when you're dead. Why don't you tell people now?" In his 2005 Stanford commencement address, Steve Jobs said, "Your time is limited, so don't waste it living someone else's life. Don't be trapped by dogma, which is living with the results of other people's thinking. Don't let the noise of others' opinions drown out your own inner voice." And his now haunting words have impacted me tremendously because I have been trapped by dogma and other people's thinking. My true voice has been suppressed and silenced. And as a result, I've been living a life of secrecy, duplicity, and hypocrisy. But that stops today. I don't know what the future holds for me. I don't know exactly how my wife or my extended family will react or how I'll be treated in my community.
We're here for you.
Thank you. If they fault me for being honest, then so be it. Robert Frost in an interview once said, "Freedom lies in being bold." And I ask myself, and I ask you, can we ever be free without being bold? So while I have been freed from faith and belief in my mind for several years now, for me, the celebration of true independence comes literally today. It comes right now Now, as I finally find the boldness to openly proclaim to the world that I'm no longer a member of the clergy or a person of faith, I live with reason as my guide, and I am an atheist. While I like to talk, I love to sing. So I'm going to sing a song to you that I wrote in 2011. I remember recording it and sending it to Linda and Dan. And I said I was just trying to capture what it felt like while I was 2 years out from giving up on God. But I remember that confusion, that betrayal that I still felt as if he were real. And so I tried to capture that in a song. So, but also to express the excitement and the freedom that I would hopefully one day enjoy. So I'm going to sing it for you now, before anyone, for the first time ever. So. Called Life After You, and bear with me during the first part of the song because I'm singing it to a God that's not there. Okay. I was searching for the truth. I thought I knew it. I thought it was you. You were my best friend. I never thought this could come to an end. Whoa, whoa, never end. You were my source of strength, my solid rock, my hiding place. If everyone deserted me, you'd stand beside me. Never leave, oh, 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 never leave. Now I'm here all alone, so empty now that you're gone. So I'm crying while I'm trying to pick up the pieces that you left behind. And I'm wondering, and I'm waiting to see what comes of my new life. Life after you, oh, after you. Looking back on all I went through, I know I thought too highly of you. But now I know you could never be something you're not, and that has set me free. Whoa, whoa, set me free. It's okay that I'm here all alone. Life has more meaning now that you're gone. So I'm yearning and I'm learning to think for myself and live what I believe. And I'm searching and I'm finding that reason alone had the power to set me free. Well, I said reason alone had the power to set me free. Oh, set me free. Whoa, I'm free. I am free.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've got one more little surprise for you. We mentioned that that over the internet, having never met one another, we collaborated on what I think has been titled Liberating Hymns, right? So we're going to do one of those for you just now. I sent Dan a bunch of music, and I said, I've got some ideas. I'd like to rewrite some of the words to some of the hymns that he and I both knew so well for so many years. And so we picked one we're going to do for you tonight, and it's called The Solid Rock. If you were in the church and you knew it, the chorus went, On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. The new title of this song is called The Solid Rock of Science.
My hope is built on nothing less than facts learned from hypothesis. I dare not trust the sweetest myth, but wholly trust in science. On science the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When problems rear their ugly face, I trust minds of the human race. When all around my soul gives way, knowledge is my true hope today. On science the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When we are sick and prayers all fail, medicine can cure our ails. I do not trust in God's good grace. Real hope is found in science. On science the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Religion is corrosive to science. It teaches people to be satisfied with trivial, supernatural, non-explanations and blinds them to the wonderful, real explanations that we have within our grasp. It teaches them to accept authority, revelation, and faith instead of always insisting on evidence.
One day I hope all men will see religions harm humanity. The greatest tools for our ascent, education and enlightenment. Sing with us. On science the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
We have a few minutes for questions, and we're going to call Linda and Daniel up here too, as co-founders of the Clergy Project. You might want to ask some questions about the Clergy Project itself. So here is here's the cream of the crop. Here is the Clergy Project itself. So
there are microphones here and here, and we've got a few minutes to take questions. So let's start here.
Is this on?
Go ahead. Oh, the mic isn't on, Buzz. Somebody? We'll alternate sides.
What a bad guy, huh?
Oh, let's start with Sue Kosher.
Okay, well,
that mic is not either?
No, wait, maybe it just needs to be tried. I could have sworn I heard something here when you walked by.
No. Not working.
Andy, I can talk on the
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So, hey, thank you very much for that.
Hold it up.
It's not working. I'll just talk about it. So, my question is, you had mentioned you had talked to your daughter, and she had said, well, why don't you just tell everybody, but you had not mentioned if you had told your wife yet, and if so, does she know, or what's the plan to tell her?
The question, do you want to repeat it?
Okay. Yeah, the question was, I mentioned speaking to my daughter, so obviously she knew about it. My son also knew about it. My wife has known that I struggled with faith for quite a while. In the last few years, we really didn't talk about it that much because it really upset her. But she did know that I was coming to this event. But really, it's, you know, the reason that I took so long was, I think, to try to protect my family. But then I really thought about, you know, ultimately, I just cannot be myself for the rest of my life. And I think even through conversations today on the phone with them, it's been very positive. So.
Sue, do we have a mic working now?
I don't know. Yeah.
Yay.
It's a miracle.
So I am amazed and thrilled to know how large the Clergy Project has become. I really didn't know it was that big, and that's awesome, and congratulations to all of you for getting it started. So I'm wondering what we've learned along the way, and what's different now between how the Clergy Project works and what happens to people as compared to, say, the first year.
First, let me say that although Linda and I both helped get this underway, we're not members. We can't get inside. We're completely outside the Clergy Project because we are neither current nor former members of the clergy. So whatever I know about the Clergy Project, it's what I learn indirectly from people like Carter.
Who's Carter? Oh, yeah. Daniel, will talk to that too.
So there's more than 600, and they come to it as a landing. It's 700. 770, where have I been? I've been planning a convention, I guess. They come as a landing page to compare notes. What books did you read? How did you tell your family? What job did you get? And some of them need counseling, and we have referral for counseling. Some of them need job training, but there's a lot of forums, secret forums. How nice to have a group that none of you have to join, right? It's just, unless you were a former clergy. And it's very refreshing to just share stories and talk, and there's money. The Todd Stiefel Foundation gave money for transitional grants to retrain, to get an honest job. And so it's pretty exciting to see all of that happening, and there's different forums for liberal, for conservatives, for different types of churches, and of course the Southern Baptists all want to talk with each other, and the Church of Christ instrumentalists want to talk with each other. But it's really pretty fun, and it's exciting to read some of the stories. And of course, Linda and Dan talk about that in their book, Caught in the Pulpit.
Yeah. Over here.
Is working? Yeah. Okay. Two-part question. What is the composition of the Clergy Project with regards, and I'm going to make three groups here, or you can make different groups, but Catholic clergy, biblical literalists, and liberal Protestants. So how is the composition of the group? And then what are the different struggles, and how differently are there different struggles to that, those groups?
I can't give you exact numbers, but I can say there are many more fundamentalists than any other kind. There are most are other Protestants. There are a minority of Catholics, although they exist as well. There are many more men than women, and there are many more former clergy than there are active clergy. And it's been that way from the beginning. Even when we started with 52, those ratios were similar to what they are now, and we don't really know why, but that's the way it is.
Yeah, I think probably of the 770, about one quarter are still active clergy who are trying to, most of them, some are okay with where they're at for whatever reason, if they're in a very, very, very liberal congregation, and they're almost to retirement. And I'm like, you know, so we talk about that and their struggle with it. Some of the other struggles are, you know, as Dan mentioned, is dealing with family or loved ones or friends. How did you come out to people and let them know? Stress because of financial needs. Some people, which I encourage, don't make a hasty decision and just say, I can't take it anymore, and stand up one morning and just tell them all, and then lose your job immediately, because as good as that might have felt to tell them that for that split second, you know, you've got to pay bills the next week. And so we try to, sometimes we talk people down from what they really would like to do. It's a very encouraging community. And you have to remember, pretty much all these people have gone into this career to begin with because they care about people. And so it's a very compassionate group. It's just we've refocused that compassion.
Do we have a quick question there?
Well, yes, there. I have two quick questions. One has to do with my observation that in two different cities I have lived in, and I'm sort of an outsider from religious groups, I have known two people who have left the clergy for sort of unknown reasons. And I would like an idea of what percentage of the clergy this might represent, and you people who are working on this might have an idea of what percentage this would represent. That's my first one. And then well, you might want to answer that first. And then the other one is just as simple.
I can't give a percentage, but I also have a guess, because I talk to people, you know, that I meet, and they don't know about the work I do, and they ask the wrong question, like, what do you do, or what research project are you working on right now? And I tell them, and if they're clergy, and I always welcome clergy to come and talk to me, sometimes they will look scared when I say what I'm doing, and I interpret that as they are feeling that way too, that they're kind of afraid to talk to me because they assume that I know what they're thinking. And then I've also had other people, when I told them what I do, they'd come up to me and they'd whisper to me, you know, I could be in that study too. Maybe I should join the Clergy Project too. And I mean, they'll just come out and say it. So I don't know the numbers, but I suspect there are a lot of people out there at different stages, but they're sort of stuck where they are. And there's a lot they like about their work. It's not like it's horrible. There's a lot of that clergy do that's very good and that they really enjoy, so it's hard to make that switch. Too bad they have to believe all that stuff in order to do something good.
And my second question is, how soon will there be something published that I can read about on this topic?
Well, you can answer that question.
Well, I'm not going to publish anything about the Clergy Project because, as I've already said, I'm on the outside looking in. If there's a project underway, and I wouldn't be surprised, because there's a lot of, when you've been writing sermons all those years, there's a lot of talent and a lot of eagerness to communicate, but maybe Linda knows the answer.
Yes, I know the answer. There are two books out. You wrote one of them with me, right?
I was figuring she already knew about that.
But I don't know about
yes.
it.
Yes. So there's okay. that. It's called Caught in the Pulpit, Leaving Belief Behind, and we're going to be signing copies of it very soon. And in fact, Carter here is going to also be signing. You're going to get books signed by him if you like, because he's quoted in it quite a lot under another name.
My hearing aid's not working too well, so I must have missed
okay,
it.
Okay, I will.
Thank you.
And then the other thing is there is a book out now called From Apostle to Apostate, From Apostate, am I getting it wrong?
Apostle to Apostate.
From Apostle to Apostate, written by Catherine Dunphy, who is one of the original members of the Clergy Project and was a participant in the Dennett La Scola study, which is a story of the Clergy Project. So you can, if you talk with me later, we can look that up as well.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Hi there. Let's see. This will work, hopefully. Thank you again for all of that. That was amazing. And welcome to this family. I'm newly out as an atheist as well. It's a good feeling. I'm curious. I've always looked at minors and children, and especially with childhood indoctrination. Now that your worldview is different, is your perspective on your role or clergy's role in influencing children changed? Do you want to try to do something towards that?
Yeah, that's my own personal perspective. I look back at things that, you know, obviously I was teaching what I thought was truth. And so I don't know that I ever saw any damage from that, but I've heard horror stories from maybe more extremist or beliefs. I don't know. I really don't know what I'm going to do about it right now. I know I'm just going to try to be honest with people, how that starts. I think there's a fine line between how you can step in someone's parenting role and trying to step into that because it's their home and their thing. But I think my role is hopefully to talk to the adults, and because you're not going to have access to the children, nor do you really need that access to them. But if you can make the parents think or the adults think, hopefully you can bring about positive change. That's a good question, though.
I'd like to add something to that. For a number of years now, I've been advocating that study of world religions be an obligatory part of all schooling from primary school up through high school. I think one of the problems is that everybody is so afraid, they misinterpret church-state separation and think that we mustn't ever talk about religion in school. No, religion is a natural phenomenon. It's just as important as global warming or economics or politics. And it should be taught evenly, factually, and what I particularly like to urge is that it should be obligatory for homeschoolers too. And when people say, but you know that they will do a terrible job teaching it, and I say, that doesn't make any difference. I don't care if they tell their children, this is the devil's spawn, but you have to learn it because you're going to be examined on it. They still have to face the fact that their children are not going to be sheltered from that information about how people in the rest of the world view their lives.
So I have a good friend of mine whose whole life pretty much revolves around religion. Like, if he became an atheist, I think his marriage would kind of fall apart. So I was kind of wondering, because it's kind of the same situation with like a minister, like their whole life is enamored in this. Is it like ethical of me to try and convince him otherwise?
You want to speak to
me? No, I won't.
I think you just need to be a friend. I've never been a confrontational person. I do anything to avoid confrontation almost. And I'm usually a peacemaker. I really believe that every person needs to be respected initially. They might lose that respect with, you know, doing something crazy or outlandish. But so I think just honest dialogue, which a lot of people are afraid to do. I do understand some people, they're so entrenched and so ingrained that I wouldn't encourage anything to happen drastically, but I think just subtle subtle influences and talk might be the best route to take.
All right, thanks. And one more thing. That song that you wrote was really amazing. Have you ever thought about putting some more like production value in that and like releasing it?
I've got three or four more that I've written, but I've never performed them for anyone. So.
Mm. Well, you should perform them more, I think.
Hi, my name is Marilyn Melmauer. I am a physician. I was born here in Pittsburgh, but moved to Los Angeles. I have a practice there. I came back for this. When I was 17, I visited my grandfather here, and I was in the Catholic Church, went to confession after talking to my grandfather about a part in the Bible, and the priest said to me, no, you don't read the Bible, you read the Missal, at which point I stood up and said, this is America, and I walked out. I never went back. In my office, I violate all the rules. I talk about politics and religion, and my patients love it. Mm. Okay, and I have many free books, the Bible, Atheist Bible. They love that too. I tell them, my religious patients, you give people that are doing good, you give a religion a good name. I give them credit. Look at us. Most of us are gray and bald. Okay, we're old. Good for us. But what are we going to do for the young people? We need to be honest. We need to be loving, kind, and honest.
You're talking about the Clergy Project, but I'm curious, are there any rabbis who have a discussion group? We have, our daughter has a friend who has gone through rabbinical training, and after listening to everything that he studied, you know, it's like really hard to imagine how this young, bright man can believe in God, except for maybe his six-figure salary. But anyway, you're nodding your head, so that's a good thing.
There are rabbi members of the Clergy Project, and there are two rabbis who participated in our research as well. But I just want to tell a story about when I would tell people about the project, and if I was talking to Christians, they would say, oh, I don't think, you know, that my pastor would have any of those strange atheistic beliefs. But when I would mention it to Jewish people, they would say, you know, I bet my rabbi doesn't believe in God.
Well, I'll just close with something that just popped in my mind. I shared this only with Linda, my experience the other morning. You know, this has been on my mind and thinking about what do I really want to say. And so I was hurrying to work, and I went to FedEx to drop off a package, and I pulled out of the FedEx parking lot, and a car pulled directly in front of me, and stopped me, so I could not move and exit. And I thought, what is going on? And the guy rolled down his window, and we repositioned our cars, although I couldn't get out. And I said, what's going on? And he said, I hate to do this. He goes, you're not gonna believe my story. He goes, I'm traveling from X point to X point. I have $1.30. I've lost my credit card. I don't have money for gas. Similar story that I would hear a lot at the church when people would come by looking, wanting money. But his was very, very plausible or somewhat plausible. And I thought, you know, normally sometimes I help people, sometimes I won't. It depends if it makes sense. And I thought, it could be that way. And so I looked at my wallet, and I had one $20 bill in my wallet. And I told the guy, I said, I've got $20. And I said, I'm going to give it to you. I said, I normally don't do it, but I hope it meets your need. And as soon as I handed the $20 bill, he leaned forward in the car, and I saw a huge cross around his neck. And I just thought it was very interesting. I was just going to give it to him. And he said, God bless you. He goes, you are an answer to prayer. And he said, I didn't say anything. I was getting ready to. And then he said, by the way, will you keep praying for me? Because I've got to make it to a certain place by a certain time. And I thought, you know, that split second reaction, I thought, should I bring this up or not? And I said, And I said, well, actually, I said, I don't believe in prayer. And I said, but what I do believe is this $20 bill is going to do you a whole lot more good and get you where you really need to be.
Right on.
And when I shared that with Linda, she goes, you know what? Sometimes we don't take those opportunities, even as leaders in the non-belief community, I think she was talking about, or people, she goes, you know, we just pass things off or we don't want to bring it up. And, you know, I just thought I wasn't abrasive. I was just being honest. And when I told that to the guy, by the way, his jaw just dropped and he said, okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Linda, final words there.
I'm just so thrilled that Carter, and I have to get used to using that name, has finally been able to be himself and that we're all here to appreciate it with him and all of you as well. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
Can you get a photograph?
And Dan? Okay. You're going to get a photograph. Oh, okay. We're just going to take a quick photograph for posterity, and then we're going to bring on our Emperor Has No Clothes awardee this year, Lawrence Krauss.